persecution in Britain following World War II. They're somewhat parodied in the film at the beginning and the midpoint. You know, I imagine that the members of the Who's kids were, their audience, who were taken to these places as vacation spots in the late 40s and early 50s. So the song is partly a poking fun at that, I think. But also, I think Pete Townsend is saying something about the kind of mass youth gatherings that are starting to happen at the end of the 60s that have a vaguely spiritual or utopian-seeking purpose to them, or ambience, like Woodstock, where they famously perform, actually. And then if you think about Woodstock, that might lead you to think also about Altamont, which happened 3 months after, which is notable or famous, at least in part, because there was a killing at Altamont, which is captured in the film Gimme Shelter by Rolling Stones. And you could argue, I sort of think, that the final third of Tommy rather foreshadows this real life sequence that happens months after the release of Tommy. Because Tommy's holiday camp is going to sort of collapse under the weight of its conceit, and specifically Tommy's conceit. We don't learn about what is the essence of his message to his audience or followers until the very last track, called We're Not Going to Take It, which contains the most narrative in Tommy. Welcome to the camp, I guess you all know why we're here. My name is Tommy, and I became aware this year. If you want to follow me, you have to play pinball. So put in your earplugs, put on your eye shades, you know where to put the cork. Tommy is apparently doing what in psychology we call prescribing the symptom. In order to be like me, in order to have this awareness that I implicitly have, you're going to have to suspend your senses, become temporarily deaf, dumb, and blind. Because through mental affliction is the potential for growth. There's that theme again. And he's imparting this, I guess, to his now avid followers. But he's doing it, if you think about it, in rather a didactic and kind of a nasty way. You know where to put the cork? Really? And the kids, the followers, who are not all right, and by that I don't mean that they're troubled, because I've learned teenagers in my practice to be troubled, they are not going to take it. You know, they came to this holiday camp, they sought out a leader, they followed Tommy implicitly because they wanted some other kind of relationship. They're like Pete Townsend in the late 1940s or early 50s. They want more reciprocity. They want someone who's going to listen. They want a more democratic world. They want something other than what Tommy appears to be giving them. So there's a cautionary tale in the subtext here. And the sense that what goes around comes around, history repeating itself. Tommy becoming the autocrat that he was himself felt oppressed by. A theme that I actually think The Who better articulated post-Tommy in an equally famous song called Won't Get Fooled Again. If you know that song, you must know his famous coda, Meet the New Boss, same as the old boss. But you might also know the rather the beautiful prayer that precedes it. I tip my hat to the new constitution. Take a bow for the new revolution. Smiling green at the change all around. Pick up my guitar and play. Just like this. And I get on my knees and I pray. We don't get fooled again. Those words, that then groundbreaking synthesizer, actually, that drum solo, that scream, still sends chills to my spine 40 plus years later. Back to the finale of Tommy. Where am I? Tommy at the end of the opera is something of a lone and plaintive figure. You know, the revolt has occurred, the kids have rebelled against the Tommy's holiday camp, which seemed to have an air of hucksterism about it. It seems corrupt or again didactic or something. Autocratic. But Tommy saying, "See me, feel me, listening to you one more time," only now it's not an internal song, now it's an external song. And it's like a prayer, it's like a hymn. And he seems not celebratory necessarily, sober, perhaps, depressed, maybe, mildly. And so we hear, "Listening to you, I get the music. Gazing at you, I get the heat. Following you, I climb a mountain. I get a sign at your feet." There was never a sequel to Tommy. I suppose there might have been, given how popular it was. And I suppose you can have something that autobiography of your Townsend to think about why that was. So as implied here on this slide, I did my own thinking about a Tommy sequel and for the purposes of my paper and the kind of film school that only a therapist could think of, Tommy was in a therapy. That's only for someone like me, of course. I'd be the perfect match, I think. And what would he talk about? He might talk about his depression, is what I imagine. I can only speculate, obviously. I think he'd talk about his depression, a mild depression, and a positive depression, which might strike people as a strange term. There's a point about that Melanie Klein theory. The point of growth from the paranoid schizoid position was to something she called the depressive position, which was another position in life human beings can inhabit. And the depressive position is one in which an individual has learned that he or she can do harm, experience guilt, and repair. It's nothing to be gotten over, this depressive position. It's something to achieve. That was the idea. A state of what analysts call mourning. So, I don't know if Tommy would be in the paranoid schizoid, everybody's against me position, or in the I've learned something depressive position. He might reflect on his attachment history. He might have ideas, he might be able to talk about the watershed event of 1921, or it might be gone from his memory. You know, just to say a little bit about the practice of psychotherapy and psychoanalysis as it influences it. I am influenced by so-called object relations theory, which is the kind of branch of psychoanalysis that covers people like Melanie Klein and also people who are lesser famous but have been influential to me. James Masterson developed a clinical method for the treatment of what we call personality disorder, or more commonly, what he called a disorder of self or personality types, with the idea that personality is comprised of the aggregate of emotional and interactive experiences of a person's life. I could say that phrase over and over and over again, but I'm not sure whether or not that would really mean so much to you. But I think about today, what does personality mean? What does self mean? The ability to form an image or what is called a representation of self and other. Neurobiologists now believe infants have the capacity to do that towards the end of the first year of life through a part of the brain called the orbital prefrontal cortex. And a man by the name of Alan Shore, who has been cited in literature over 17,000 times in medical psychiatric literature, and might one day be a household name. He is the principal neurobiologist responsible for that discovery. Now, please don't ask me to explain how he came to discover that. I don't really know. It's through MRI technology. But that ability to form a representation of who I am and who you are is thought to be in the late infant's mind. I imagine might happen in therapy? Well, an axiom, I'll show this, an axiom of psychotherapy that more or less cuts across most styles, I suppose, is that what happens in a person's life somehow gets replayed in the therapy room on, say, a thematic level. So, in other words, I'd be sitting, let's say, with this hypothetical Tommy Fool, and I sense maybe his grandiosity, his disappointment, all those things that I was talking about. But I think the thing that would really, I think would be profound for him, if I sensed actually that very old message that was buried in his unconscious, that don't talk about it thing, if I found a way to say to him something like, you know, Tommy, as we're sitting here together, I feel your reluctance. I feel a pressure in the room. But somehow, there's something you and I are not supposed to be talking about. That's really where my imagination takes that. Never to be written script. Okay. I don't think I'll say too much about narcissism or schizoid personality. Therapy would not look like poor Roger Daltrey here. would not use any contraptions or anything. I bring this up. Actually, I've already talked about that. Let me talk about the Who themselves for the last couple of minutes, and then open this up. I think about the unfolding of their career. Tommy was 1969. It's 50 years plus, and they're still going. I went to see them in Vegas in August. So their career is still going. These lists of capacities, by the way, James Masterson figure I alluded to, sort of devised a set of capacities for human beings to aspire to, either in therapy or outside. And with respect to the Who, I think of the capacity for intimacy and spontaneity. Capacity for intimacy, because I mean what I always thought was a rather special relationship with their audience, and how the Pitanza wrote about the relationship with the audience implicitly from one album to the next, even Evan's front. And, you know, and from the outset, when he was copying the dances of mobs on floors of social clubs in the early 60s, that was a way in which he was communicating to you. As for spontaneity, come back to the Cow Palace, 1973. Scott Halpin was the name of the 19-year-old, or was the name of that 19-year-old, who was invited on stage to play drums with The Who that night, but Keith Moon collapsed over his drums. Imagine that, right? Concert stops, right? And the guitarist steps up, and it's a pissed off British accent, says, "Can anyone play the drums? I mean somebody good." And Scott Hampton's buddy nudges him and goes, "You can play drums, you should get up and give it a shot." And minutes later, this kid is on stage with The Who, then thought to be, if not the best rock and roll group in the world, one of them. And he's finishing out the set, and won't get fooled again, whatever you play. And that, for me, is one of the coolest things that ever happened in the world. And it happens spontaneously. This last image. One of my last images. again, very resonant, I think, with people who are British, the St. Paul's Cathedral. During the Blitz of 1940-1941. From a backdrop of war, of horror, an artist emerges with a story to tell in their chosen medium, be it art, literature. These young men chose rock and roll. They start from what you might think of as the paranoid schizoid position. Why don't you all fade away, right? Rejecting others, seeing persecutors and annihilators all around them, that my generation victim. I hope I got it before I get away. But they move on, sort of, achieve perhaps perhaps something like the depressive position, to transcend all that violence of the early years, acquire some spirituality, learn to engage with their audience, I think, in a deeper, fuller way. They become superstars, achieve their share of success, on most accounts, partake in a great deal of mischief, suffer the odd tragedy, which is well documented. Today they are elder statesmen of rock and roll, as I suggested, 50 years and going. Giving back also, citizens. Some of you may know of their rather robust charitable infrastructure called the Teenage Cancer Trust that they support, where they give back to the audience, I think they observe so long. Scott Halpin had his once-in-a-lifetime moment. This is one of mine. I got to meet Pete Townsend in the spring of 2016. He's holding my paper there, actually. We should just... he didn't say much, to be honest. He just finished a two-hour concert and was barely conversant, I'd say. God bless him, you know. Posed for a nice photograph with me and my wife, Maria. We've been forced to listen to a lot of Who songs over the years. Have you gone deaf? I don't know. I think rock and roll helped me grow up. So there it is. Here's some of the. I'll go back and forth. I've got one more slide that indicates the reference for the paper that I wrote and I published a couple of years ago. Here's some of the references from that paper that informed that paper and, of course, this talk. Thank you all so much for listening. I do want to open this up. If anyone has questions or if you just want to share anything about rock and roll, the Who, the 62, whatever, that's all this.
Yeah, I assume that you've read Townsend's autobiography.
Portions of it, yeah. You mean Who Am I?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The connection with Tommy, with aspects of his own childhood, his mother, walking out of the family, and his own experience of being sexually abused as a child. Thoughts about that, Tommy? Anything for that?
Well, it's interesting that he's writing that, you know, towards the end of his career and later life. I think what you might also get from that is that his creative process, it was actually quite unconscious. And by that I only mean intuitive. There's a sense that when he was writing Tommy, or even proto-Tommy works, like somebody mentioned The Quick One While He's Away, that he's already writing about abuse, even though he doesn't seem to be thinking about it in his life during the creative process. It's almost like his life is split into two parts, the creative, intuitive, unconscious part, and then the part where he's making sense of his art, the second half of his life. That's how I understood, you know, those aspects of Who Am I. Thank you. Yeah.
Has anybody ever deconstructed Tommy in terms of Tommy's chronology?
Good question. In Before I Get Old, a book I referenced earlier by a critic called David Marsh, there is an attempt, pretty much, to say here's the chronology of the events. But it doesn't, I've never read anything that seems official, like that here's actually what happened in the story. I do believe that the Who's manager, one of the early managers called Kit Lambert, produced, if you like, a script for Tommy. And in that, but I don't know if that's ever been published, actually.
I'm sorry, I was thinking in terms of, he would have been born at the end of World War I.
The beginning of World War I.
Okay, but you know, in the mid-teens, and that would put him at roughly 25 in the Depression. Mm-hmm. And 35 in World War II. So I was trying to see if there was anybody who had sort of against the real life events that were taking place in that time frame?
I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, through the history of the Who, Townsend's always given several different stories of the same story. Case in point, breaking the guitar for the very first time took place, from what we know, at the railway venue in outside London, 1964. People who were in the audience, he took the guitar off, short ceiling, headstock snaps, he's in an amphetamine rage, breaks it because he's in front of his art school buddies, which is Eric Clapton, John Lennon, other members of the mod community, probably Elton John. They're making fun of him. And he had like a sense of insecurity that was always documented by other musicians in that scene. If you look at his interviews at the same time, about 1964, 65, he's poking fun at the Stones, he's poking fun at the Beatles. There's a lot of back and forth amongst these mods. Even the Stones come out with Get Off My Cloud, making a jab back at them about all coming in and dressed up in a Union Jack, referring to the famous jacket to him that he had made of the British flag. So I've always wondered, you know, with Townsend, you always get several different stories. You know, he says, yeah, I broke this guitar at the railway at this venue in 64. Then a few years later, he says, oh, I was learning about destruction in art from a German art teacher at my art school, and it was an art statement. So I've always wondered, studying the Who, you know, where do you get the real story with him? And especially for the roots of Tommy. And you also get like a quick one while he's away, where they wind up with 10 minutes of tape left on the second album. And Chris Stamp comes to him and says, we need more songs. Write a 10-minute song. And Townsend, in protest, then writes 3-minute songs that takes up a 10-minute segment and calls it a rock opera.
Yeah.
So I've always wondered, you know, is Tommy about himself? Is it about somebody he knows? What's your feelings on that?
Well, I like one comment you make, because I've always thought that all the members of the Who were sort of delightfully unreliable historians. I always find this so hilarious how they would contradict themselves and each other like all the time. Yeah, so it is very difficult to get a secure narrative out of them. My sense of who Tommy was based upon, you know, that's fascinating. So it has never occurred to me to thought that Tommy the character was based upon some actual individual. I guess I might, in line with this other gentleman's question, imagine that Tommy might have been Pete himself. That I haven't. But otherwise, I haven't wondered how he might have been parodying, poking fun at peers of his generation. Although it's lovely to think about that.
More than almost any other comparable band, the Who never came to terms, Pete Townsend never came to terms with femininity at all, with women. The Tommy is written entirely for men. It was performed by men at first. It's later, even Tina Turner gave a fairly masculine performance, but they don't do love songs in the traditional way. Love is tied very much to abuse and exploitation. And as a therapist, you must have thought about how there could be any kind of reconciliation with normality without in some way coming to terms, as even Hamlet did with Ophelia and Gertrude.
I'll cite an exception from Tommy that might speak to your point. And I didn't talk about this song. There's a song in Tommy called Sally Simpson. This lesson known, which is about a fan of Tommy. And this is based, I think, on an incident at a concert the year before Tommy's release. The Who are opening for the Doors in New York. And Pete Townsend observes Jim Morrison being abusive to fans, kicking fans. And in Sally Simpson, because I think he saw like a female fan being injured, perhaps, in this scene. And he writes the song Sally Simpson about a girl who goes to a concert and gets hurt. And this is not one of the more famous songs. I've actually always wondered why critics seem to not like this song. There's a lovely lyric in this. It's about Sally having an exchange with her mother about being interested in boys and Roscoe's. She knew from the start, deep down in her heart, that she and Tommy were worlds apart. But her mother said, "Never mind, your part is to be what you'll be." I always thought Pete Townsend had a sympathy, or developed a sympathy for his female audience over time. I don't know that I could cite too many letters that exhibit that. I do think it's correct that he, and probably wasn't the only one, had a disdain for the screaming teenagers that made the Beatles famous. I think he sort of deliberately wanted to be louder than the audience. So I do think that was an aggressive gesture, and it's implicitly directed at the female audience, because that seemed to be the female audience and rock and roll audience that made the British Invasion initially what it was. And that's all I'll say with respect to that. Thank you. One other question I thought you might want to see.
Well, I was just going to mention that my understanding there was a lot of influence of Pete Townsend following in his interest in Mayor Baba on the storyline of Tommy and the spiritual avatar, the character of Tommy who didn't speak, Mayor Baba didn't speak his whole life. That was part of his teaching, and that was my understanding of a big influence on his conception of Tommy and the spiritual teacher. And then kind of the revolt against the more, trying to make it kind of more institutionalized, as he did in the holiday camp, where he revolted and said, no, you just have to do, what I do, in a more Eastern kind of spiritual way.
Yeah, I do think that Mayor Baba serves as another kind of model for the wisdom of the silence.
One thing I see in Tommy is, I take it in as he's had this experience that, or set of experiences that brings him to self-actualization or spiritual realization or something, and it seems to be a thing of, because these things made it happen for him, that is the way to do it, which is not unique to him. I think a number of spiritual figures have done that through history, even minor cult leaders. Do you have, I'm kind of curious about the psychology of that. Is it just that focus at work for me, so this must be the one truth, or do you see something else in that?
I have an opinion about it. It has to do with narcissism. It has to do with I think the Tommy character gets caught up in a very sort of human way, meaning, that it's commonplace, as you suggest. Getting caught up in his celebrity, getting caught up in what analysts call a fusion between self and other, where you kind of lose a sense of a separation between self and other. So that would be the psychoanalytic explanation for why you'd assume that what's important to me must therefore be important to you, right? And lose sight of difference. So that's, I'm not saying that's the definitive way to look at that, but that's a take I've had. Okay, well, again, thank you all so much for coming out.
The song.